March 16, 1998. The survivor is Miriam Stanton, maiden name Spencer. The interviewer is Emily Erdman. The city is London. The country, United Kingdom. The language used is English. My name is Emily Erdman, E-M-I-L-I-E, E-R-B-M-A-N-N. Today's date is the 16th of March, 1998. I'm conducting an interview with Miriam Stanton in London, United Kingdom. The language used is English, and this is tape one.
What is your name?
Miriam Stanton.
Could you spell that, please?
S-T-A-N-T-O-N.
And your first name?
Miriam.
Could you spell that, please?
M-I-R-I-A-M.
What was your name at birth?
Sandra, S-A-N-D-Z-E-R.
And what is your date of birth?
6th of May, 1914.
How old are you? How old are you?
6th of May, 1914. I'm 83 years old. I will be 84 in 6 months.
Which town were you born in?
In Warsaw,
Could
Poland.
Could you spell Warsaw, please?
Żurawia 45.
No, sorry. Could you spell Warsaw for me?
W-A-R-S-A-W.
And which country was that in?
Poland.
Thank you. You just told me you were born in Warsaw. Did you grow up in Warsaw?
Up till I was around 6 years old. And then I was sent to boarding school.
Where?
In Germany.
Where in Germany?
In Agnetendorf, in Riesengebirge. That's near Breslau. It's in the mountains.
Why were you sent to boarding school?
Because Warsaw was occupied every week by somebody else, either Russian or Polish. And we had a very lovely apartment, was always confiscated for the generals. So my parents decided to went to Katowice in Silesia, where my maternal grandparents were living, and to leave the children. And the bank manager, my father's bank manager, said, why don't you send them to boarding school where my children are, to leave them alone? So that's why we went to boarding school, my brother and myself.
Do you remember the names of your paternal grandfather?
Yes, Moshe Majerovich.
That was the father of your father?
My maternal grandfather.
Your maternal grandfather. What was he like? What was your maternal grandfather like?
What was he?
What was he like? What kind of a person was he?
He was, to me, he was a gorgeous person. He had a little beard and short and stout. And he was always having on his button a little parcel. There was some sweets on it. And it was every week somebody else's job to take it off. And we had the sweets there. He was gorgeous.
Where was he from?
He was also from Poland, from Sosnowitz.
And your maternal grandmother, what was she like? What was her name, first of all?
She was Sarah Majerovich. That's the grandmother I went to concentration camp with. Not concentration camp, it was an alien camp. And when my grandfather passed away, she came to live with us.
What about the parents of your father? Did you know them?
Oh, yes.
What was your grandfather's name?
Shoah Mendel, Sansa. He was a big man with a big white beard, and he sat like a king at the top of the table. He was absolutely gorgeous, absolutely gorgeous.
Where was he from?
He was also from Benzin, which is the next town. Between Sosnovitz and Katowice was just a tram tram car going backwards and forwards, because it was two little villages, and they were 90% Jewish, and they both lived there.
So we've spoken about your father's father. What about your father's mother, your grandmother?
She was also from Benzin.
And what was she like?
She was short and fat, and a very, very good cook, excellent. And we loved to go Sabbath there to lunch. And she was very kind, and she always preferred my brother and myself. They had an enormous amount of grandchildren, because my father was the eldest of 12. And she had a lot of grandchildren, but she always had special parcels prepared for us. But I also remember my great-grandmother, her mother.
Yes, what was her name?
I don't know what her name was. See, we used to call her Babciu, it's in Polish, little granny, Kupka, because she wore a little cap with ornaments here. And for Sabbath, she had a special ornament, you know. But she never wore, her hair was always shaved. Instead of wearing a wig, she was more religious. She wore just that little beret. It wasn't a beret, it was like a little turban in black silk. And she looked just lovely. So we called her Babcia Kupkala, because she was in Polish, it is Kupka. And Kupkala is a little cover of the head, you know. And she was very sweet. And what I remember the most of her, that she wore one of those old dresses with about six or seven
garments.
That's right. And she used to lift them up when she saw us. And in the last one was a pocket, and she took out some sweets, special for my brother and myself. All the other children had the sweets on the table. Very special to her.
What was her name again, your grandmother's name?
She was my grandmother's name.
Yeah, what was your grandmother's name again? Your father's mother, what was her name again?
I don't know.
What was your mother's name?
Frida.
And her maiden name?
Majerovic.
When was she born?
In 1989.
And where was she from?
She was born in Sosnovitz. In Sosnovitz.
Near which big town would that be?
That was in Silesia. Benzin and Sosnovitz were twin towns. And my father from Benzin and my mother from Sosnovitz. And my father used to go to a yeshiva. And he was a very handsome young man. And one day, the two grandfathers knew each other very well. They were good friends. They used to go to the same yeshiva. And one day my maternal grandfather came home and says to my mother, "You are engaged." I said, "Oh, am I?" So he says, "Yes." She said, "May I know who it is?" So he says, "Yes, Hune Sandra." So she was delighted, because he was so handsome. She used to admire him when he walked in the street. So she never met him before, you see. But the girls always looked at the boys going to the yeshiva, you know. And she was very happy about it. Whether he was happy, I never asked him.
What was your mother like? What was your mother like?
What can I say? She was gorgeous. She was very young when she got married. She was only 15. And my father was 15 and a half. And they were married. They were under 31. They got engaged before, and then they were married. They were just 31 together, the two ages together. And she saw him only going to the yeshiva and coming back from yeshiva, etc. And she always liked him very much. He was a very handsome man, young man, very handsome.
What was your mother's family like? You've talked about your grandparents, but what were her brothers and sisters like? Did she have any?
My mother's brothers
your
and
mother's, sister. Yes.
My mother had actually 7 brothers and sisters, but 5 of them died when they were youngsters. And when I was born, my mother had a sister, younger sister, and a younger brother. She was the oldest of the 3. And the younger sister, unfortunately, they suffered from TB. So she died pretty young. She was under 30 when she died, and I was very sorry because I adored her. So my mother remained with 1 brother only.
What was your father's name?
Avram Huna.
And when was he born?
He was born a few months before my mother, in January.
Which year was this again? 1889. And where was he from, your father?
Benjin.
What did your father do for a living?
He was a merchant. He was importing and exporting and selling, and I don't know what he was doing. We were never short of anything. He was a businessman.
Was he in military service during the First World War?
Yes, he was a Russian soldier.
Did he ever talk to you about that time?
The only thing I remember, he never talked very much about it, but what I remember seeing him in uniform as a little girl, and also an incident when I was born, my mother had a very difficult birth, so they sent her on holiday a nursing home in the country outside Warsaw. And it was poor. One day they put her into the woods. It was in the middle of the woods, the nursing home. And it was starting to pour with rain. They put her in the armchair, and she could not go in, and they forgot about her. And when my father came to say goodbye to her, because he was in the army, they remembered that she was outside. So they brought her in wet, and she developed right away. She had very bad flu. And he kissed her goodbye, and he caught the germ. So the next day, when he went to the army and was in the barracks sleeping, when the next morning when he woke up, he had high temperature. So he couldn't go with the army. But he went to the hospital. They put him in the hospital. And when he got better, he came out to my mother and looked out. He had 2 weeks. He had 2 weeks off the duty, and when he went back to the army, he had a high temperature again. So they said to him, "Excuse me, where are you coming from?" So he told them what happened. He says, "You're the only one surviving out of your whole company." He says, "Why?" He says, "Because when they left and you couldn't go, they walked over the field of mines and a whole lot was killed, and you're the only one remaining." So his illness, twice he had it, was a blessing to him. And he never went, they never called him back.
What was your father like? What sort of a person?
Well, it's difficult to tell me that he was absolutely wonderful. He was a very, very handsome young man and very kind. He was a very kind man, very warm-hearted. And he taught me a lot of things, which I carry out, and I'm very happy about it. He was a very, very nice man, but he was a businessman. He was not a worker. He was a businessman.
Did you have any brothers or sisters?
I had two brothers.
What was your elder brother's name?
Jack. They called him Kuba in Polish.
What was he like?
He was very nice, very nice. He protected me. And then he went out with girls. He always came home with a little parcel of a present for me. So when I woke up in the morning, I always saw on my bedside table a little present from him, because he went out. And I wanted to go with him, but he didn't want me to go with him.
What about your younger brother? What's his name?
Bill, William.
What was he like?
He was 10 years younger than I am. So... also very nice, I must say. He was like my son, because I looked after him during the war. My husband looked after him, and he was, after the war, we brought him here. When I was married, we brought him here, introduced him to a lovely girl, and he got married here. But unfortunately, he's dead now, about 9 or 10 years. He had cancer. He died.
It's maybe difficult to say, how did the three of you get on, because one was so little. How did the three of you get on? Because one was very little and one was older than you.
Well, with my older brother I got on very well. With my younger brother, he knew me better than his own mother. He looked upon me like his mother. And when he came to London, he was living here, right here. And how shall I say, it was a very warm and united feeling.
What language was spoken at home in Poland?
German.
And outside the home?
Outside the home, the country's name. My mother taught me Polish, because we moved away from Poland in 1920.
To go where?
We went to Berlin, where my maternal grandparents moved to, or my uncle moved to Berlin. My father was a partner, lent my uncle some money to buy some cinemas. He was in the cinema business, and my father was a partner. So we moved to Berlin, and my grandparents adored their son, their baby son. And from there, my father came to Paris, and he decided to stay in Paris.
So how long did you actually live in Berlin, or were you at the boarding school?
One year, with my grandparents. My grandparents had an apartment, and we lived with my grandparents. And when my father realized that it's no business for him, so he went to Paris, and we stayed on till my father was established here.
So When exactly did you move to Paris?
1920.
And so did you go to school there?
No, wait a minute. No, I am wrong. 1930 we moved to Paris. 1930.
Had you finished school by then, or were you still at school?
Yes, yes. I finished school by then.
Can I just ask you if you know, I know you were too young at the time, but do you know what the relationship was in Warsaw between Jews and non-Jews before the war started?
Very bad. Very bad. Anti-Semitism was very high.
Do you remember anything of
yes,
this?
Yes, I remember we had a lovely apartment with a big balcony. And I remember the 1st of May was a march, because 1st of May the workmen was working. And we were standing on the balcony and looking down, my mother and whoever was in there at home with us, because we had the apartment in one of the best streets, like Park Lane was in front of us, you know. And there they were walking, like Oxford Street, they were walking there. And I remember that they were shouting, "Down with the Jews, down with the Jews, their blood should run in the gutter," etc. And also what I remember, that I came down for Passover, my parents, or for the Jewish New Year, my parents used to buy us new clothes. And we went down very proudly with our new dresses. We were, I was about 12, and my brother was about 2. And we were walking down the steps to go for a walk. And the housekeeper came down, came out of their lodge and poured ice water over us with our new clothes. And he said, "You dirty Jews, you need that." And it was terrible. Can you imagine ice water, pieces of ice on you?
So after that, what was it like in boarding school in Germany, in Silesia?
In Sarah Honegger in Agnetendorf, boarding school was very nice.
Was it a Jewish boarding school?
The owners were three sisters, unmarried sisters. Sarah Honegger was the eldest one. And she had two sisters as well, younger one. They were Jewish. But they didn't practice the Jewish religion at all. But there was no anti-Semitism at all. We had a lot of very high class girls. For instance, Esterházys were there, which was Esterházy was the family in Hungary, Lord Esterházy, you know. And their daughters were there, and from Vienna, the royalty was there, the children. We were all friends, and I don't remember anymore who they were, but they were very high up. So it was no anti-Semitism there, but in Paris, in Warsaw, there was a lot.
Was your family religious?
Yes, yes.
How did your family observe the Shabbat?
They kept Shabbat, yes.
Did they went to synagogue? Did they go to synagogue as well?
Oh yes, oh yes.
How did you celebrate Jewish holidays?
Oh yes, we celebrated all the Jewish holidays. For Passover, we came home from boarding school. And we had a proper Passover with Seder nights, with everything. And Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, it was in shul, in the school was a synagogue, a room which was made a synagogue. And my parents used to come to be with us. They also came Christmas time because it was holiday time. So we were skiing. And in the summer, we used to go to the seaside, to Danzig, to Sopot. So that was our holiday. But the Jewish holidays, my parents used to come. And for Passover, I used to go home.
Which was your favorite Jewish holiday?
Passover.
Why?
Oh, yes, because I used to love the Seder night.
We take a tape break here. Hmm? We take a tape break here.
Yeah, I'm going to have some.
This is tape two. I'm interviewing Miriam Stanton. You were just telling me that Pesach was your favorite holiday.
Yeah.
But why?
Well, two things. First of all, I had as a child, you mean?
Yes.
I had a new outfit, and I was allowed to choose myself. And that was a great, great privilege. And also, because of Seder night, we were allowed to stay up late. I used to fall asleep on my mother's shoulder, but that doesn't matter, but I was allowed to stay awake, you know?
You've just told me that you went very young to boarding school. Do you remember any names of teachers or classmates there?
Oh, gosh. Until lately, I do remember Mrs. Goebbels. Mrs. Goebbels was there. It's not nothing to do with the Goebbels, Hitler's Goebbels. She was a very, very nice person. And she was first, when I was a little girl, when I was first came, in her room was three other beds. For the newcomers, when they are very small, to be secured. After we had our own rooms.
Do you remember any names of classmates there?
The what?
Of school friends?
Yes, Hansi was her first name. I don't remember now. Hansi Ehrlich, I think. Hansi Ehrlich. And they were from Vienna. And they had cinemas. And her uncles and aunts came, and they were all very important cinema owners. And we were very friendly.
You told me there was no anti-Semitism at your boarding school. How about outside the school? Was there any anti-Semitism outside the school?
No, not out. We were not allowed to go on our own, but there were several buildings, and for the holidays we were allowed to. The families used to come, and they took us out. You know, and we were little girls. We didn't. We were ready by 8 o'clock to go to bed, you know.
Until what age were you at the boarding school?
Pardon?
Until what age were you at the boarding school?
Me, until 10.
Then where did you go?
Then I went to Poland, because my mother was having my youngest brother, and she was sure that she won't survive it as a birth. So she wanted the children to be with her. Well, thank God she survived. And we were. I was in Poland after Christmas time. And then that was in April. And in September, I went to a school in Warsaw just for a few months.
What was that like?
Well, I had to learn the language first, you see. And my mother taught me Polish, and I didn't like it. I didn't like it at all, the Polish language. But I had to learn it because my mother told me that a language is a very important thing in life, and you have got to learn several languages. I said, not me, I know German and German only. Oh, she says, no, you will have to learn other languages as well. And then I realized that she was quite right, because in life my languages did help me a lot. And I speak now several languages, and it's very useful in life.
What was the time at school like? Was there any anti-Semitism at school, at a Polish school? Was there any anti-Semitism at a Polish school?
And not that I know of, no. Not that I know of.
And outside the school? Oh, you told me, yes. You told me about the ice water and all that.
But you see, in Warsaw, my parents had only Jewish friends.
How about you?
Well, I didn't have any many friends because I was only a short time in Poland.
Did you have any non-Jewish friends?
I don't think so, because I was friendly with the children of my parents' friends, you see.
Do you know what the Jewish community was like in Warsaw? How many Jews lived there?
I don't remember.
Do you know at all what the relationship was between Jews and non-Jews?
No, it was not a difference. No, we celebrated Christmas, we celebrate Rosh Hashanah, we celebrate everything together, you know. Christmas time, I remember there were big Christmas trees, enormous Christmas trees, and we helped to decorate them. It was fun, you know, but it was no difference.
So why did your father decide to go to Paris, to go and live in Paris?
Because he had an opportunity to make a business there. And my father was a peculiar person. He was a very good businessman, but he liked to start a business. And when it was really flourishing, he was tired of it and started another business. And in Czernowitz, he started a factory, a knitted factory. And we needed everything, from socks to hats, clothes and everything. And we had 36 retail shops. With partners he had it. And when it was really flourishing, somebody proposed to him to go to Paris. We had a Swiss friend, and his nephew was friendly with my father, and that Swiss friend came, and he says, Huna, how about coming to Paris and starting a factory there? And my father was all for it. So he sold the factory, and we waited in Berlin with my grandparents till he was settled in Paris, and then he brought us over.
Did you still go to school there?
Where?
In Paris.
No. I had private lessons.
Did you speak French?
Oh, yes. I did business in French.
You say you had private lessons. Did you have private school lessons at home?
Yes.
And your brother as well, the little one? What about your little brother? He as well?
Oh, no. He went to school. He went to school.
What sort of books were there in your parents' home? What sort of books were there in your parents' home?
Oh, gosh. We had so many books, especially Jewish books about Jewish religion and the Torahs and all that thing. But we had a lot of books. Did you see our library here? I will show it to you, our library. You can photograph it.
What did you like doing in your spare time?
What I did in my spare time?
Yes.
It depends. In the winter, we were skiing. I used to love embroidering very much, especially the stuff for that. And reading and enjoying life, going out and going for walks and all kinds of things.
Did you belong to any youth organizations?
No.
When did you meet your future husband?
How did I meet my husband and when did I meet him?
When and how, yes.
Well, that was a very funny story. When I was in boarding school, his parents had a building in a big block, corner block of flats in Berlin, and my uncle looked after it. And then when they came to Berlin to see how the property was going on, my parents were there. And they were just preparing to come to us for Christmas for skiing. So his parents came along with it. And he predicted, my father-in-law predicted, that I will marry his son. He predicted, and I hated him for it. I really hated him for it. And then I forgot about it completely. And when I was in Paris, and I was in charge of the factory, my father's factory, and his parents came to visit a cousin of my mother-in-law, and they were not kosher, so they were very annoyed. So they came to us, to visit us, because we were kosher, they spent time with us. And his mother predicted that I'm going to marry him. I said, now look, your husband predicted when I was a little girl and you predicted now, and I don't want to marry him. I don't want to marry him. And I got engaged to somebody else, one of our clients, an Algerian Jew, and he was very, very nice. I didn't love him, but he was a very nice fellow and very good client as well. And then one day, I went to Calais to buy some lace because I was not satisfied with my supplier. I was designing clothes and I had a contract with the White House in Paris. So I wanted special lace. So I went and bought some lace. And the manufacturer was very impressed how I was buying, how I was choosing how I was buying. So he invited me to lunch, home to his home, and to meet his daughter, who was my age and didn't want to do anything. She said, let her see what you are doing. Please come. So I went to lunch there. Whilst we were at lunch there, they decided that they are going to London to King George V's funeral, and they invited me to come with them. So I said, very sorry, but I have got to ask permission of my parents. So he was shaking his head to me, and he says, she buys thousands of francs of lace, and she doesn't have to ask anybody's permission, but to have a trip for nothing to England, she has to ask her parents' permission. I said, yes, I must ask them. And my mother said, yes, please go and get yourself a fur coat. Her cousin had a fur shop. Get yourself a fur coat for your wedding. Because no Jewish girl has a trousseau without a fur coat. You have to have a fur coat. I say, okay, mommy, I will do that. And I went to London, and the furrier was a relation of Ben's family as well. And he says, I must go and visit his mother. His mother was ill. I say, I didn't come to London to visit a mother of somebody I don't know, and especially a sick person. I came to have a wonderful time, and the manufacturer is waiting for me. She says, never mind waiting. I promised her that I will bring you over, and if she will hear that I am, that you are in London, she will be very, very annoyed, and you don't want to make a split in the family, do you? So go over, speak 10 minutes with her, and then you go where you want. So I went over. I didn't go over. She phoned up, and within 5 minutes was a car with a chauffeur there, a magnificent car, the chauffeur in gray uniform. And he opened the door, and there was a fur carpet in it. So I said, am I going to Buckingham Palace or what is it? Yeah. And I was very impressed with that, you know. And then I came to the beautiful house he had in Bromsbury, and I visited her. I didn't take off my gloves. I didn't want to take off my hat because I wanted to be only 10 minutes with her. And a few minutes later, he came in, and I thought to myself, that's the man I'm going to get married, not my fiancé, that's the man. And he sat down, and in 10 minutes, you know what? How long I've stayed there? A week. And I told my mother, you tell Leo what I am, that I want to break off our engagement. She says, you come home and do your dirty work yourself. I will do it for you. That's how I met him. And we were in correspondence, and that was it.
What was the relationship between Jews and non-Jews in Paris?
What was the
relationship between Jews and non-Jews in Paris leading up to the war years?
It was perfectly all right. Until Hitler came. And when Hitler came, you dirty Jews, get the hell out of here. And that we heard when my mother went to buy a loaf of bread. And the butcher was running after my mother with a big knife. You bloody Jews, get out of the Paris. And we decided to leave then. But we helped a lot of refugees who came from Germany, Belgium, etc. We helped a lot. Did you read my book?
Yes.
We helped them a lot.
When Hitler came to power in 1933 in Germany, what was discussed at home about that? What was discussed about Hitler coming to power in 1933?
I don't know.
You don't remember?
No, I don't know. I only know that in 1933, I saw a salesman selling bananas, which was a rare fruit in Europe at that time. And I wanted a banana, and I went and bought a banana. And when he looked at me, he said, you bloody Jew, and grabbed the banana away from me, and didn't give me back my money. That was the position, as you can imagine.
When was this? Was this just before the war?
Just before the war, yes.
Did your father have any Germans working for him?
German? What?
Did any German work for your father?
Yes, we had engineers working because the machines were from Germany, from Chemnitz. And every time we bought machines, an engineer came with them. And he was staying about 3 months to put the machine together, see that everything would be all right, and also that it should work properly. And then he left. But the last engineer stayed with us. Did you read my book? Good. About good. That was it.
Why did he stay with you?
Because what he said in the book, that he was ahead of the Gestapo in Paris.
Did you know that at that
no.
time?
Until he told me afterwards, I didn't know that. He swore that he is going to fight the Germans next to my brother. And he also officially married a woman, and she gave birth to his baby. But really and truly, he was married in Germany, and the wife came over. He was a very nasty chap, but at the same time, he helped me.
So did he stay with your father until you left Paris?
Good. He was staying with us until we ran away. One day he didn't come, and it was about a couple of weeks before, something like that. But it was a lot of strikes, and people were striking as well, because it was a passion of striking, the workman. And he settled the strike. He said, what are you striking for? You want some more pay? I said, no, we strike because everybody strikes. So that was it.
So you told me just now that when you were called dirty Jews and being harassed, that is when your father decided to leave Paris.
It wasn't in Paris, it was in Berlin. He asked me in Germany.
What happened in Paris just before?
In Paris, my mother went to buy some bread, and they were running after her. The butchers were running after her. And that was the time we decided to leave.
And when was this? Exactly when?
Pardon?
When was this?
We left Paris on the 12th of June, 1940.
12th of June, 1940.
Yes, I think so.
Hadn't the Germans come into France around May?
No. They were apparently, that's what we heard afterwards, that a lot of German soldiers were dressed in ordinary clothes, and they came as visitors or refugees. And when Hitler came in, Hitler came from the north, and we went through the south the same day. And they threw off the clothes, and they were in uniform. They were Germans. There was a lot of them here.
What did you take with you when you fled? When you went south from Paris, what did you take with you?
And just one set of clothes, each one of us, and mattresses and blankets. That's what we took. And the boot full of food, like sardines and tinned food. And that's what we had, because we knew that that will be very short. And that's how we left.
Did the whole family go?
Yes.
Did both your brothers come as well?
No, my older brother was in the Maginot Line. He was a soldier, volunteer soldier. He was in the Maginot Line, and he went to his wife and daughter. And they were in the country what was the name of it? No, I'll tell you in a minute. In Honfleur. Her grandfather had a villa there. So they went there. And as he went there, straight there to the, to his wife and baby. And we went on our own, but we traveled on her to see, to take them along with her, but she wouldn't go.
Your sister-in-law would not.
She wouldn't go. Leah wouldn't go. She wouldn't leave France, and she didn't.
Did anybody else come with you on that journey down south?
Yes, my grandmother, my parents and my grandmother, and also two workers. When we were leaving, they stopped us, and actually three, the two workers, they took, no, two clients. They had a car, they couldn't drive, and the husbands were in the British Army, and prisoners actually, and they had a car, and they asked us to drive the car with them. So I went, and Papa went and bought the car, and we filled up the two cars, and we drove in two cars. And when we came to the corner of the street, one of our workers was there with her baby, so we took her in as well. And she drove with us until we stopped one day. We were in the Exodus, you know, on the television, the Exodus, bumper to bumper, and also people, thousands of people. And she came with us, and when the aeroplanes followed us, she protected the baby, and she suffocated it. And that was it. And she stayed with the baby. We made a grave for the baby, and she stayed there.
We take a take break here.
Yeah.
This is take three. I'm interviewing Miriam Stanton. You just started describing your journey down south from Paris, how when this young woman tried to protect her baby, she suffocated it.
Yeah.
Which towns did you go through and down south? Where did you stop off?
We went to Nantes. We actually wanted to go to Bordeaux, where ships were leaving. We wanted to go to England. In driving, in walking and driving, suddenly it was a lot of hooting. And the French army was driving the same way. So we realized that it is no good, that they are retreating. And we were lying in the grass or everybody was lying in the grass on the side in the fields. That's when she suffocated the baby, because she was protecting the baby, you know. And we could not go any further. They told us that Bordeaux is now for the army. You can't go to Bordeaux. So we had to go somewhere else. And we went to Nantes. What happened was Papa and I went for a smoke, and we saw a farmer standing far away. So we went to him and said hello. My father had a Norman charm. I chatted away, and you would have thought that he is a farmer. He knew the conversation was very good. And the farmer said to him, would you like to have a hot drink? And the father said, well, I have got to go back to my family there. He says, I'll give you something. They gave us a lot of bread and cheese and things like that. And he says, if you want the night, you can have the barn here. And that was a luxury hotel, a barn. We didn't have to sleep in the fields. So my father went, collected my grandmother and the others. And we went to the barn. We spent there at night. And we had water we could wash, which was after a few days walking like that. We had no opportunity to wash, you know. It was very, very unpleasant. But we were lucky. We were sitting in the car. The others were walking, so we were not complaining, you know. But all of us, we went to the barn, and we spent there a night, and we were refreshed in the morning. And he came in the morning with fresh baguettes and cheese and fresh goat cheese, and it was very nice.
What was his name? Do you remember that?
I don't remember the name, no.
Which other towns did you stay in?
From there we went to Nantes. From Nantes we wanted to go to Bordeaux, but we could not go to Bordeaux, so we went from Nantes, we went to Toulouse. And when we came to Toulouse, it was so crowded that you couldn't get in. And when you were in, you had nowhere to park. And you couldn't get out. So eventually we got out. And we went, we saw a name called Tarp. We went to Tarp. And when we arrived on this main square, there was a lot of coffee shops, you know, the bistros, the French bistros. And we were so exhausted that we sat down and we asked for a hot drink, which we didn't have for a long time, a hot drink and baguette. It was absolutely, I was looking forward to an omelette, I was looking forward to it. And all of a sudden I heard from far away, from the other side of the terrace, calling us, my father's friends from Belgium. So we had all to go over there and talk to them. And so when I came back, my omelette was flat. It wasn't as nice, but they were going to Nice. And they were trying to go to Nice. And they said not to stay in Toulouse because they had no rooms at all. So we went to Tarp. And when we came to Tarp, the mayor was standing in the main square with a doctor, with a teacher, all the high positions in the village. And they told us they have the school ready. We can go there. So when Mummy and I went in, it was so much dirt there. Especially droppings of the mice, etc. So we didn't want to. So he says, well, go to Chateau up there and they have some rooms. So we went to the chateau, and when we arrived there, the chatelaine was not there, the owner of the chateau, she was not there, but the caretaker told us that she left a couple of rooms for refugees in case somebody comes, but no furniture. So we asked her for a table and chairs, but we brought our mattresses in, we slept on the mattresses, and we could use all the vegetables we wanted from the garden, so it was very nice. And my mother opened a couple of tins of sardines, and we had a lovely hot meal, the first hot meal for a long time. And we stayed there till we decided to go to Marseille. And my father was driving backwards and forwards to Toulouse. It was only 2 kilometers away from Toulouse. And from Tarbes, actually. And we decided to go to Marseille, but my mother was very ill. She was bleeding very badly. She needed an operation, and they didn't want to operate her in Paris because they said the Germans are any minute in Paris, they will throw you out or kill you. You better go as you are. So she was operated in Toulouse. And I went to Marseille to arrange the papers. And eventually he came down to Marseille. I was traveling backwards and forwards, and eventually he came down to Marseille. And from Marseille he went to Nice, because there was more space in Nice than in Marseille, because also the Algerian came over. And they settled in Marseille, so we went to Nice and we rented an apartment in the Hotel Luxembourg. And I was traveling every week to Marseille to arrange papers.
Can I just take you back a minute until you were living in Nice? That journey from Paris down to via Tarbes and Toulouse to Marseille and then Nice, was there a lot of bombing while people were walking?
Just at once. Yes, was no bombing.
When you were going up and down to Marseille, what sort of papers were you trying to get?
I was trying to get the hell out of Europe, wherever it was possible. So I heard the Cuban consul was inundated, impossible to get even near the consulate. And also, every day it was more expensive. They took a lot of money, but we didn't mind that. But not only the consul took the money, but all the other supporter took the money, and the secretary took the money. Everyone wanted to have part of it. Until it came to the consul, it was absolutely impossible. So I was very depressed about it. First of all, we didn't have any passports, because we left some passports behind.
And what passports were they? They
were Polish passports. So I went to the Polish consulate, and they gave us passports. But for me, here, I was short of one passport, because everybody gave us our passports, they were short. So he gave me a piece of paper with my photograph, and it was just as good as a passport, which I was very sorry I didn't keep, because to exchange for a passport in Jamaica, I sent it to Cuba, and they didn't send me back the paper, and I was very annoyed about it. Anyhow, to cut a long story short, the Cuban consulate was very busy. And it was a waiting time, years. And so I heard that the Shanghai people, Chinese people, give pass visas as well. So I took my passports and I went to the Chinese consulate, and they gave me a visa for all of us for $2,000. When I went to have a transit visa to Portugal and to Spain, Portuguese people told me the wonderful news that the last boat for Shanghai left the day before or the same day I came, and he can't give me a visa. So I was very, very upset. You can imagine how upset I was. Eventually, I heard that the Portuguese consulate was very lenient. So I went to the Portuguese consulate and I said to him the story about Shanghai. He says, I can only give you a transit visa, and that's all I can do. But you have got to have a visa further away. So I said, where do you want me to go? Wherever you can get a visa. I said, well, it's impossible. He says, well, let him give you a stamp for Shanghai, and you promise, you sign that you will not, you won't go. So I say, if you phone him, if you know him, phone him and tell him I am coming. And he did. And that's not in my book, because I don't want, if anybody is still alive, I don't want them to have trouble. And he gave me a visa for Shanghai, and I had a transit visa for Portugal. And then I had to have the Spanish visa, which was a whole article in the Spanish. Did you read about it?
Yeah.
Yeah. And that was my destination, Shanghai.
Can I ask you, in the meanwhile, what was life like, apart from going up and down to try and get visas, what was life like in Vichy, France, especially for the Jews?
Well, when I went to Vichy, France, it was, all the hotels were closed. I knew Vichy very well, because every year I used to go with my mother. And I went for the exit visas. And we were staying in a little private hotel opposite the bath where the water was. And the owner was very thrilled to see me, but he invited me to lunch. And he says, I don't know whether you know that you are here. Very, very dangerous to be for you here. So tell me the truth why you're here. So I told him. He says, don't go to the police station, because you will never come out. They put you in the back room, into the lorry, and take you to Auschwitz. So I said, so what am I to do now? So he says, give me the passports. And his son went. He knew a friend of his was working there. And he came back at lunchtime with all the passports, with the visa, exit visa for me. And he took me in his car to a farm outside Vichy. And from there, the farmer took me to the nearest station where I could take the train to Marseille. That was my experience in Vichy. It was absolutely dead. The Vichy I knew was so full of life and full of visitors, you know. It was absolutely dead.
What I also want to know, Free France, which was the south, was life free in Free France, especially for the Jews? What was happening to the Jews in so-called Free France?
In so-called Free France, it wasn't free. It was a great anti-Semitism there. It wasn't. Pétain was not a free person. He was very anti-Jewish. and it was, we could buy food, we could rent a room and in a hotel. Privately, you couldn't rent a room.
Why was that?
No.
Was that
because we are Jewish. We are refugees, and they had no space for refugees. You know? The biggest apartment, they had no space for refugees. So we had to go to Nice. And Nice was the same thing, but it was free France. And you could feel that we are not wanted there. For instance, the Hotel Negresco, which is the biggest hotel, that was requisitioned by the German officers. And all the German officers came there for a holiday. You could not go into the Negresco. But I must tell you a story about Lyon. Mm-hmm. Did you know about Lyon? I went to Lyon because in Paris, when I went back to Paris, we had a very good client.
You say when I went back to Paris, was that before you went to Lyon? Yes.
Yeah, I went
could we talk about that first, if you don't mind?
Yeah.
First of all, before you went back to Paris, I want to know more about the situation in Free France. Could Jews work in Free France?
No, it didn't work.
And were there any roundups?
Not that I know of. The only thing I know, which we saw ourselves, Hitler and Mussolini driving up and down the Promenade des Anglais. I saw them. We had all to go inside and draw the curtains. But my mother and I were very, very anxious to see them. And we lifted a little bit the curtain. We looked out and we saw them driving into Italy. Mussolini came to invite Hitler to come down to Italy. And then in the evening, he drove back and we saw them both. But it was very, very, very difficult.
You told me you went back to Paris. Why did you go back to Paris?
Because we were having tea in the Hotel Roule, which was the hotel, and my mother and I, and we saw somebody coming in who came from Paris, a friend of ours, and we waved to him, and he came and sat down with us, and I said to him, did you come for visas? He says, yes, we came, we are outside on the south of France, etc. And I told him that I'm going next day to Paris. To, he said, why are you going to Paris? I said, I'm going to persuade Jack to come with Leah and the child. He says, don't bother. I said, what do you mean, don't bother? Why shouldn't I bother? He says, he has been taken last night by the Gestapo, 2 o'clock at night. They knocked at the door, and he knew that it would be the Gestapo, so he jumped through the window onto a terrace down below. But he didn't realize that the whole house was surrounded, and he couldn't escape. And he was taken to the Gestapo. And that's why I wanted to go and free him, to try to free him, to do something about it.
So how did you go back?
Well, I had official papers. I went to the police station and I asked them for papers, for visa to go. You had to have a stamp to go to France, to Paris. And I could go back to Paris. A lot of people went back to Paris. And as I am a very spoiled brat, I was struggling, sleeping car, first class. And I saw other friends of ours on the station. And they were traveling third class because, not because they had no money, it's because they were traveling backwards and forwards, their husbands were traveling backwards and forwards, the family was here. And they said, it's all right, you don't have to put the third country. When you come to the border, all the people who were first class, they were arrested by the German, and the third class went through. So I had a look at the third class. I said, my God, I wouldn't like to travel here. I said, take me, let them take me, or let me have a comfortable night first. And I slept, went to sleeping car. And I was very, very worried about it. And our friend came over and asked me to come back to the third class because all the people in the first class are being arrested. Well, when I came to Paris, the only car, wagon, which arrived in Paris was my wagon. The rest was all stationed on the border, and I never saw my friends again. The whole car was taken back right straight to Auschwitz.
Did anybody check your passport? Any Germans
at
the border?
Oh, yes. Yes. The, on the border. I asked the attendant in the sleeping compartment, how is it? Do I have to go down to the border or they come up here? He says, no, don't worry, they come up here. And I know that my father greased his path very much. And he asked me because I want coffee. He says, real coffee, not substitute for coffee. So I had a cup of coffee. He bought a whole jug of coffee. And I thought to myself, that's something. He must have been really greased well by my father. He brought me the jack and I talked to him, and he gave me tips in conversation, you know. I caught some tips how to behave. And when he left, I had my identity card, which was like a harmonica that lengths 12 pages. The French card was just a booklet, and I was a foreigner. My father never wanted to take on the French nationality. I don't know why, but he was very stubborn about it. So being a Polish subject, I had to speak harmonica. So I tore off the first two pages. That was pale green and the other was pale yellow, and I put it in a plastic thing, you know? And with my photograph on one side, and the, all the explanation, all the dead, bursts of date, etc. And it worked. It worked. I gave that to them. I prepared myself just like for the night. I put my long hair in curlers, etc., and take off my makeup. And when they knocked at the door, I was fast asleep, so I pretended. I was fast asleep, and I gave him through the door just my card, you know, the booklet. And I heard one German to the other saying, don't you see, it's all right now, she's okay, let's go on, I'm tired. So he gave me back my papers and I went through, right through. I think that he wants you. That's right.
We'll take a deep break here. Mm. Thank you. This is tape four. I'm interviewing Miriam Stanton. You just described your train journey to Paris. What happened upon arrival? Where did you go?
I went to my sister-in-law. And I put down my suitcase and I went out right away. First of all, I heard from her what happened. What has happened at 2 o'clock in the morning was a knock at the door, a very hard knock, and Jack went through the window, jumped down to somebody's terrace, and went through there, ran away. But they caught him. And he went to jail. And she does not, what she's worried about, quite rightly, is that he most probably will be sent to Auschwitz or to any detention camp. But uncle and aunt, they might find somebody to do it, to do something about it. So the next day, I heard that a cousin of mine, of my mother's, Raja, who was like a brother to me, you know, like an older brother to me, that he was in Paris as well. He was living in Cannes by now. During the war, he had an apartment in Cannes with his wife and little boy who was in Cannes. So I went to him and I told him what I'm going to do anyhow. I went to the Gestapo building and I did not know what to do. There was a queue outside. And I went with the queue. And when my turn came, I went in. And I was worried out of my life. Where am I going to go? It was a long corridor there. Which door shall I knock? And if I knock the door, what am I saying? What am I going to say? All of a sudden, behind me, when I was halfway up, behind me, I heard a familiar voice giving orders in German. When I turned around, I nearly had a heart attack. It was the engineer from our factory, Kurt. I don't remember his second name, who pleaded with us to stay behind because he got married and his girlfriend has a baby, etc., etc. And when I turned around and went over, he says, "Miss Sandra, why are you here? You are trying to do something for Jack." He says, "Meet me at the Café de la Molde. It is in the Grand Boulevard." And I see you after 5 o'clock. Get out of here. So when I went out, I couldn't believe what I have seen. And I was walking the streets in a trauma. And I crossed the road in a trauma, and a policeman grabbed me just before a big lorry or a bus was nearly killed me because I was in such a state. That he who pleaded with us, that he is going to fight with us against his own brother. He is there like a general. So I walked and walked and walked, and until I got very tired, and I sat down on a cafe on a terrace, and I asked for a coffee. And the waiter asked me, "You need not a coffee, you need a brandy to pick up." I said, "I don't drink brandy, just give me a coffee." And all of a sudden I looked at the watch. It was 5 o'clock. Because I walked such a long way, and I asked him, where am I? He says, in the Bois de Boulogne. My God, I grabbed it. I put a few francs down for the coffee, and I grabbed a taxi, and I went to the Quai du Mart, into the Café Quai du Mart. And I was sitting there a few minutes, and he came. In, not in uniform, in ordinary clothes. And he says, what did you have? I said, I had coffee. He says, we can't talk here, let's go. So he took me in his car, and I was sure that he's going to take me straight to the police station. And he took me to another cafe in the Place de la République. We sat there. And he says, you came to save Jack, don't you? I say, yes. He says, don't worry. I look after him. He's not going to be sent away. But I need 50,000 francs. And it was a hell of a lot of money.
Why did he need 50,000 francs?
To bribe the others. He says, not for me. I must bribe the others. So I said, can I meet you tomorrow? He says, but promise me one thing. You won't go home. Don't go home. Your home is surveyed. So just don't go home. So I went to my cousin, Sim Brightbone. He had a workshop in on the Grand Boulevard. And there was Vera, also a friend of his. And I was in a terrible state. He says, first of all, come on, did you eat something today? I say, eat? What did I eat for? He says, you have to eat something, because you look to me that you are just completely exhausted. Come on, we are going to eat now. So we went to eat across the road. And then I realized that I haven't eaten all day long. And I was very thirsty. And I drank a whole jug of water. And I told him what happened. So Vera said, look, first of all, don't go home. Stay with me overnight, and we see what we can do. So I said, first of all, I must try to get 50,000 francs. So I went to one of our customers, who was an Algerian, non-Jewish people, but very wonderful, Peter Stetten, very, very wonderful, and they were very friendly with us. And when I walked in, they couldn't believe their eyes that I am here. The uncle who heads the business was a very wealthy unmarried man, and he employed two nephews, and one nephew wanted to marry me, but I wouldn't dream of it, but anyhow. So I say, is your uncle here? So he says, yes, he's here. Wait a minute, I'm going to give him a surprise. I said, well, don't give him a heart attack, but give him just a surprise. And we went into the uncle, and he was so delighted to see me. And I told him what it is. He says, have you got the money? I said, no, I haven't got the money. He says, here is the money. And he went to the safe and gave me the money. And then I decided, I said to him, look, I have no opportunity to bring back the money. He says, don't worry about it. I say, I do worry about it. What I want you to do, here are the keys of my factory, of our factory. Take all the goods, everything you want, plus the machines. He says, what do you mean, plus the machines? He said, take over the whole factory and start working in it. The engineer is, so I told him what Kurt was. he was at the Gestapo. So he says, I have my own engineers and it will be working for you to come back. And he took over the factory and he gave me the money. As I went back to my cousin and I said, I don't need your money. I told him what happened. And we had a wonderful dinner in a restaurant and I slept with that lady, which is Vera was her name. I don't remember her family name, Vera. And she had an apartment and I slept with her. And the next day, we all went down to the south of France, back. But whilst I was there, a lady came in who was a sister of my aunt. They emigrated to Grenoble. And she came back to save something from the German. And she wanted to ask him advice what to do to my cousin.
What was your cousin's name? Sorry.
Gertie was her name.
And surname?
My cousin's name? Sim.
Oh, yes, she said.
Sim Brightwood.
And who? And the lady who was your aunt's sister, what was her name?
That's right.
What was her name?
Gertie, I don't remember her name. Isn't in the book her name? I don't remember. She was my aunt's sister, and she was not very well. And she was also a little bit, the mind wasn't 100%. But she had a husband and a lovely boy, a very nice boy. And she came back to also to try to sell her factory. They had some trouser factory or something like that. And she was such a person that she knew that the Germans won't bother with her. So we went together, we had supper, and now what was I telling you?
You were actually leading up to the day that you went back to southern France to free zone.
I went back to Perrostetten to the manufacturer and gave him the keys. And then I went back to my cousin Sim. And she invited me to stay with her overnight. And the next day, I went to my sister-in-law and told her what I have done. That I went to the Gestapo and I met Kurt. And she said that she heard that my brother is going to be freed. So he greased their hands, you know, right away. So I had to go because I could not stay longer. Kurt told me, don't stay one night here. They are looking for you, you and your father. So just keep away. But I must say that the manufacturer, as a Perrostetten, as a the boss of Perrostetten, I forgot his name now, Monsieur Benard invited me to stay in the chateau, but I preferred to go down to south of France to be with my mother and my father, you know. I must have felt that I miss them, that I won't have my mother for a long time, because I knew that she was very not well at all, you know. And I wanted to be with them. So I went down, but she had no papers. So she said, look, if you don't take me, come with me. I go straight to the Eiffel Tower and I throw myself down.
This was Gertie?
Pardon?
This was Gertie who said that to you?
Gertie. Yeah. Gertie went to the Eiffel Tower. She's going to the Eiffel Tower if I don't take her with me. So Sim said, don't take her with you, she won't go. I say, I know she's mad enough that she will do it. I know she's very mad, but she will do it. And I will have my conscience all my life. And she has a son, a teenage son. So just, if you don't want to come with us, we are going to smuggle ourselves across. And he went with us. And we went to a farmhouse.
Where?
Because we had to leave Paris.
Yeah, where was the farmhouse?
The farmhouse was, we went to Chartres. From Chartres we took a car. In Chartres, she knew some people in Chartres. And they took, they told us to stay in Chartres for overnight. Because first thing in the morning, the milkman is coming from the farm and he's bringing urns of milk. And he knows somebody from who works at the border. And you will be able to get across.
Were you at that time, sorry to interrupt you, but you were in France, in Paris, which was occupied by the Germans.
Just speak a little bit louder.
You were in a part of France which was occupied by the Germans. Were you, as a Jewess, allowed to use public transport?
Yes, yes.
This was, when, where, which year are we in now?
1940.
This was still 1940?
Yeah, yeah. Okay. We were allowed to take public transport because they had only part of Paris, a part of France occupied. The whole of France was not occupied. We were in free France. Remember that.
Yeah, but when you were in Paris, you were also allowed to.
Yes.
So what happened? Can we go forward again? What happened at the farm?
At the farm. Now, at the farm, the milkman came and he took us. We were hiding behind the churns. And when we came into the lorry, there were a couple there as well, behind the churns. And he was very well known. And we went across to the border. And when we came to the border, he said to us, the farmhouse is there. Now, if you go to the farmhouse, to one door is occupied France, the other door is free France. So you go into one door and come out the other door. But in the meantime, he didn't know that the German soldiers were there. And when we came, we went over the fields. All of a sudden, I heard, halt, halt. And two soldiers were on horses. And we had to stop, otherwise they would have shot us. I showed them, I have regular papers. Actually, let me tell you something, I was worst off with actual papers. But they didn't know, they were two innocent soldiers. When they saw a stamp from the police, I was very lucky with that. Absolutely luck, not cleverness, just luck. He saw the police stamp, so he's all right. He didn't read, because he couldn't read French. He was only speaking German. And I understand German very well. I went to school in Germany, but I didn't tell them. So I knew what they were talking about. And one said to another, let's go, because they have official papers and I'm tired, etc. You know? So we passed them by, they let us go. But in the meantime, I saw that Gertie's missing. So I had to go back to find Gertie. And she was lying fainted in the grass, in the high corn. I took her, where I took the strength for, I don't know, and I put her over my shoulder, and it was, the field was very wet, and because of the, because it was raining, and it was very wet, and my feet were going more and more into the mud, especially with a heavy weight. She was very thin and very light, but at the same time was a heavy weight for me. And when the soldiers came again to us, so I said, at least help me to pick her up. I insulted him, I said, how dare you allowing me to carry her? Pick her up for me and put her on the shoulder. And she weighed twice the size with the mud on her. And I, but my cousin went straight up, because we were told beforehand, don't hold hands and don't wait for each other, just walk. And he walked to the light where they showed him the light, that is 3 francs. And he walked, not realizing that I'm not behind him. And all of a sudden he realized that I'm not there. And people said, come on, Sim, don't wait, don't wait, don't wait. Well, eventually I came. And when I came, and he took her off my shoulder, I fainted from anxiety, you know. And they took me to a hotel, and in, I lied down in the mud, muddy things, whatever I had, and on the bed. And the chambermaid came in, and she prepared a bath for me and cleaned my clothes and everything. And from there on, we had an easy journey to south of France.
Which town was this, where you came across into free France?
In my book it is, I forgot the name.
Don't worry.
Shall I look it up?
No, it doesn't matter.
I forgot the name. It was a little village.
Do you remember at all near which... Which yes. area it was?
Near the border. Near the border. Free France. And I can tell you something. That was sheer luck. And when I phoned my mother, she fainted when I told her what it is. So mother and daughter fainted both on the telephone. And then from there, the farmer took us to the station. She went to Grenoble to her with husband and child, and we continued our journey in on the train to Nice, to Marseille, and actually my parents were in Marseille already to receive us. It was a very, very traumatic journey, that journey, but I didn't go back again.
When was your brother released?
A day after that, and the next day, and he phoned.
And where did he go?
To home, to his own wife.
Why didn't he leave Paris?
He left Paris shortly afterwards, because I brought Argentinian paper for him. You see, we bribed the Argentinian that with here papers, and he could leave.
So did he come to the south?
He came to the south, yes. And he came with my family. But it took quite a while, because he tried to persuade his wife to come. And I have a baby, Danielle. She's a grandmother today. And last week she was here. And she wouldn't. She wouldn't go.
Why wouldn't she go? Your
sister-in-law. She didn't want to leave her parents and her sisters. Two sisters and her parents. She wouldn't leave them. She is not frightened, and she is just, God knows why. And he came by himself, and he came also with my parents down to Portugal. And then he went to Brazil and finished his life in Brazil, where he came back after the war, but he couldn't get on with his wife. Was already bickering with her, and not he didn't, but she bickered it all the time. It was just impossible to be there. When I went to visit them, I couldn't stand it. So he left her.
To take you back, a little bit even before your trip to Paris, as you know, I did read your book. You were talking about an incident at the Spanish, with the Spanish consul. What can you tell me about that?
Well, the Spanish consul was a fantastic incident. It was a long queue. People were waiting weeks for him to open. And if he opened, he had two or three visas he gave, and the rest was closed. But anyhow, when I came, it was two rows all around the not just the building, but, you know, the whole, how shall I say, the whole block? Yeah. Block from one street to another, all around it. And it was two, I was in the second row. By the time, in a few days later, was five rows. And people in wheelchairs and people in brought mattresses, and he did not leave the place. Well, I had befriended in the boulangerie, the baker, across the road. And she took me in the back room and gave me a cup of coffee, etc. And one day I came there, and when I left the queue, we always came back to the same queue. For the weekend I left to go to Nice, and I came back to the same spot, and I brought some presents for all the people who looked after my spot, you know. And when I went in, her husband was in the back, and he showed me to come, winked at me to come. So when I went into the back to have a cup of coffee, he told me, he has delivered bread there to the consulate. They won't open today anymore. In fact, they won't open the week. I overheard them that they won't open the week.
We take a tape break here. This is tape five. I'm interviewing Miriam Stanton. You were just describing that the Spanish consulate only opened for a few visas a day and was now going to be closed for the next 2 weeks, I believe. So what happened then when you found that out?
Well, when I found that out, I was very depressed, and I didn't want to go back to tell them, because I knew that it would be a revolution there, because there were people in wheelchairs and this baby, especially a lady was highly pregnant and with a baby in her arms. And it was pathetic. It was raining and it was cold. Even if it wasn't a cold climate, but it was wet and people were tired. And the pregnant woman had a little boy of 7. And he was running backwards and forwards to bring stuff. And I told her to go across to the bakery. Maria is her name. To Maria, she will warm up the bottle for her. She says she can't because she might lose the spot. And her husband is in the defense. And she might, apparently the police is looking for her to intern her in the resistance. So I took the bottle and I went across to warm it up. And the baker who was delivering the bread to the Spanish consulate, he winked me to come in. So when I came in, he says, he delivered bread there, and he's delivering now again, but he won't open this week anymore. The whole week will be closed. So I warmed up the bottle and gave it to her. But I didn't tell anybody anything. I went to the post office and I phoned my father. I was determined to open that door. I was determined. And I said to him, bring me my fur coat, bring me that big hat, and I want some diamond brooches. I think I have that picture somewhere. Some diamond brooches. And I want some rings from my mother. And my father said, I come with the first train tomorrow morning. Okay. He came and I was staying in the Hotel de Noailles, and I changed there. And I took a taxi, and I went straight to the consulate. I had 11 passports. I had from ours was 5, and then Sim was 3, and another, my uncle and aunt, they were 4. So I had 11 passports. Had them in my handbag, and I dressed myself up with 2 clips in the hat, 2 diamond clips in my big hat, with a fur coat, rings on my hands, and I went, took a taxi, and I took 2 50-pound notes, took a 50 francs note, and I went to the consulate, and I gave. And I said to the taxi driver, will you call the doorman for me? Because I was frightened that the people who will in the queue will recognize me. So I was frightened. So he went and called the doorman. He looked like Franco. I have never seen such an image. You would have thought that he said double Franco. And he came out, and I said, could you help me out of the car, please? I have an appointment with a consul. He says, well, I haven't heard about it. He says, don't be rude to me, because I am going to report you to the consul. And I gave £50 note to the chauffeur, and when he gave me the hand, the 50 franc stuck in his hand, you know? And he took me in. I was inside in the waiting room. I said, my God, now I'm inside. What am I going to do now? So the consul, the girl came, and she asked me what it is. I said, I have an appointment with the Monsieur le Consul. So she says, just a minute, sit down. And Monsieur le Consul came. He looked at me, he says, Madame, come in. I came in. He says, I don't remember having had an appointment with you. I say, if you come for a visa, you have had it. I say, I didn't say that you are, I didn't say to you, I know you haven't had an appointment with me, but the only way to come in is to say I have an appointment with you. And I don't want one visa, I want 11 visas. I said, he says, look, if I don't arrest you, it's because I admire your pluck and your the courage you have got to come. I said, just a minute, come with me. Have a look. Have you seen the queue? He says, yes, I haven't got the right to give them a visa. I will lose my job if I give them the visas. I am forbidden completely to give the visas.
By whom?
By his government. So I said, so you protect your job and you want all those people to die in concentration camp? Can you have that on your conscience? Have you got a family? Imagine your family would be in that queue. How dare you to protect them, your government? The Portuguese consul is giving visas freely. Stand in the street, he doesn't give a damn about the government. You can have any amount of passports, a Portuguese visa. Why can't you do that? I said, come and have a look. There's a woman, highly pregnant, with a baby in her arms. She hasn't got a shirt, a nappy even to change the baby. She has to have it in paper. Have you got a conscience to that? Can you do that? So you looked at me. He says, how many passports is that? It's 11 passports. He says, I can't do 11 passports. I say, you have to have a few hundred here. You better see to that, because they are, if the police comes, they are going straight to Auschwitz. I mean, how can your conscience allow it? If you can save all those people, how can you allow it? I just don't understand it. I just don't understand how a human being can do that. And do you know what? He says, give me your passport. I says, they're on the desk. He said, 11 passports. Did you collect them down there? I said, no, that's my family. My parents, my brothers, my cousins, my family. I gave me the 11 passports. Oh, that ring I put on the table. And he refused to have that ring. Quite a few refused because it's a pearl. Apparently a pearl is unlucky. I was very lucky with that pearl. And he gave me the 11 passports. He says, come tomorrow morning. And I came with my father. And my father had enormous charm. And he invited him. He gave me the passports back, all stamps. And there was no queue. I said, what did you do with the queue? You know, they are in the police station. They are on the way to Auschwitz. He says, no, they are on the way to Vichy. You better go to Vichy and help them. Because we worked the whole night to empty the queue. They all have visas, transit visas, to go to Spain and to go to Portugal.
Where was this consulate? In Marseille? This consulate, the Spanish consul, was in which town?
In Marseille. Marseille. In Toulouse, they didn't have a Spanish consul. They didn't have a Polish consul, but maybe a Spanish consul, but I didn't have any passports. So the Polish passports were given to me in Marseille. And in Marseille was a Spanish consulate. And to get a Portuguese visa was very easy. You just go and you get it, and that's all to it. Because the consul was marvelous. He was absolutely wonderful. And I tell you something, the Portuguese people were absolutely wonderful. In the street, they stopped you. Você é refugiado? Are you a refugee? I said, yes. Here's my card. If you need anything, don't hesitate.
Can I just take you back? You've now got, you're in Marseille with your father. You've got 11 visas in your passport. Now what happened?
We went back to Nice.
Mm-hmm.
but my parents would not go.
Why not?
Because Leah would not leave Paris, and Jack would not come without Leah and the baby. And my mother said, we have to wait. I said, I'm not going to wait anymore. I waited a couple of weeks, and I spoke to him, to Jack, and he says, Miriam, how can I leave my wife and the baby? I said, Mother, I'm going to Portugal. Because in case the whole of France is going to be occupied, then we were all trapped. Somebody must be outside to be able to get you out. Just like I'm doing it here, I will do in Portugal. Please, Mother, come with us. I want you. Leah doesn't want us. My mother said, I have got a heart. My father said, I haven't got a heart. I wait another week or so. How can I leave Jack behind? How can I leave Jack behind? So I said, right, I'm going.
What date are we now?
Pardon?
When was this?
Must have been 1940, 41, something like that. 40. When France was half occupied.
France was occupied. France became totally occupied by Germany in 1942, November 1941,
because I was a year in Portugal.
No, this is before you went to Portugal. Right.
Yeah.
So this was 1941.
Well,
you went
40,
to.
No, I think it was 40.
40.
And then. So I had all the visas done for Spain and Portugal. Now I had to go to Vichy for exit visas. So I went to Vichy. And when I came to Vichy, you wanted to stop me?
No, I would just wanted to ask you, to get to Vichy for exit visas, is this what you took to me about previously, where you stayed with the hotel owner and he told you not to go, and he got the visas for you, or somebody did?
Yeah,
that was then, was it?
Yeah.
Right, so what happened once, so who got the visas for you?
Where, in the Vichy? In,
yes.
His son got the visas for me, and the hotel owner drove me to a farm. And from the farm, he left me in the farm. And from the farm, the farmer took me to the nearest station. And I took the train from Paris. I don't remember the name of the station. I have it in my book. I don't remember now. And took me to the station, and from the station I went to Nice via Marseille. And in Marseille I met my parents. My parents came to me.
What had happened in the meanwhile in Vichy? This hotel was in Vichy, where you were staying. Had anybody come looking for you in Vichy?
The next day after I left, it was raided. And they asked, who is the suitcase for? A client came yesterday and she disappeared. She went out, she never came back. So she confiscated my things, my overnight bag.
Why did you leave your bag behind?
Because I couldn't go back to the day. I couldn't go back. You see? The owner asked me, now, from here, I take you covered up in my car. You cannot go back. Is there any thing of value there? I said, no, just a change of clothes, etc. He says, leave it there. Leave it there, you're not short of it. And come with me. And he covered me up. I was lying in the back of the car on the floor. He covered me up with parcels and suitcases. I don't know what it was on me. Until we came to the farm. And the farmer took me out, he took me out from the car, farmer's car, and right away he took me down to the station.
So now you're a Pekingese with 11 visas, 11 exit visas. When did you go towards Portugal?
I didn't go right away. In the meantime, I had to go to Lyon.
Why?
Because the owner wanted to buy the old goods we had.
Which owner? Of the factory?
No, I'm mixing it up. I sold, when I was in Paris, I sold the goods which we had to our customer who helped me to get out. And he phoned us that to my father. He phoned my father that he's taking the cases out. So my father said to him, take also the machines out, take the lot out, don't leave it here. And he says, now, haven't you got a contract for more, for the future deliveries? And my father says, yes, I have. But whether they will deliver, I don't know. He says, you send Miriam there, they will deliver it to me. So I went there. I went to Lyon. Lyon was a free town, a free city. And when I booked into the hotel in the evening, and I went down to the evening meals, and when I came to the hotel, to the restaurant, I nearly had a heart attack. It was covered with German officers. Absolutely covered with German officers. So the waiter gave me a little table in a corner. And a young girl sitting alone, one of the soldiers came and knocked his head, saluted me, can you join me? I said, it was pleasure, but for the moment you must wait till my husband comes. You must ask his permission and then we can join you, or you can join us. And he says, right, we wait for your husband, salute. And I asked the waiter to call me to the telephone. I went up to the telephone and I went up to the room, packed my suitcase, ordered a taxi, went straight to the station. And there was about 10 o'clock in the evening. The train was about midnight or 1 o'clock. So I had to sit on the station for 2 hours. So I decided I'm going into the station master's office to phone my parents to tell them to be in Marseille because the train goes to Marseille. And I phoned to Nice and my youngest brother answered, and he said that the parents are in Marseille. So I said, phone them to Marseille and tell them that I'm taking the night train and I will be tomorrow morning, 7 or 8 o'clock in the morning, in Marseille to pick me up from the station. So when the station officer heard it, he says, would you like a cup of coffee? I said, I would love a cup of coffee. So he ordered coffee and sat down. He says, now tell me the truth. Why are you here? So I had to be very quick. And I told him I had an aunt who looked after her. And she died. And I didn't want to feel. We had a funeral today and I didn't want to be in her flat. So I phoned my brother too. That I'm going to Marseille to meet my parents. Oh, he was very sorry for me. So he said, stay here till the train comes. Don't sit by yourself in the empty station. So I was very delighted because to a girl on her own, the Gestapo will come, or the policeman will come, vos papiers, s'il vous plaît, and you have to prepare everything. So I was with him, and he says, I will try and get you a sleeping car, sleeping department. compartment. I said I would be very grateful. When he came back, he says, unfortunately, all the sleeping compartments are taken from London, from Paris. So it's none left. But we are putting on new wagons. And I ordered you first class, a corner by the window. And you will be able to sit there. I reserved it for you. So I was very happy with him that, well, I was sitting there and bought by say evening paper, and I started reading the evening paper. A lady was sitting across from me, nobody else. And eventually, by the time the train left, the compartment was full. Another couple was sitting by the door, and in between, first class is only three seats. At the last minute, two soldiers came in. Oh my God. So I saw two soldiers get, but I said, they are funny uniforms. I realized a hat is not a French hat, it's a Polish hat. So I read the paper, and eventually I understood what they were talking because I speak Polish. And understand Polish, and they were having an auction. The fellow next to me, across the table, the fellow next to me, how much would you give her to have a nice time with her? He says, 20 francs. He says, I will give her 30 francs. And I have a purse, so it was an auction going on there. And I was keeping my papers up and up and up. And I was saying, my God, what am I hearing here? Eventually we came to a stop. And the couple left. And then the next stop, the lady left. And I was alone without two soldiers. I didn't tell them I understand Polish, but the soldier next to me sat over there and told me to lie down. I said, not on your Nelly, I'm not going to lie down. And I was sitting and talking to them. I had a dictionary. I gave him a dictionary, and I spoke only French, you know, and I showed him. I kept him busy till we came to Marseille, 7 o'clock in the morning. I was absolutely exhausted, and he said to me in French, very bad French, you are a very nice girl. So I answered him in Polish, but you're a nasty bastard. And I went to the window and I called my mother in Polish. So he said, where the hell are you from? I said, I am from Warsaw. And they disappeared. They disappeared, but that's not the end of it. Two weeks later, a friend of ours had told me that he invited me to supper in the Ruhr Hotel. He invited a couple of soldiers, friends of his, who are going to England to spend a week in the Nice. So he would like me and his two cousins, girlfriend cousins as well, to spend a nice evening with six of us. So I said, yes, with pleasure. And when we were meeting in the Ruhr Hotel, through the door, the round door, you know, the turning door, came those two soldiers. And when they saw me, they continued and they ran off. So he was running after them. I said, don't run, I will bring them back. And they came back and they apologized to me for what they did. They discussed it and that was the end. And I invited them to come to Nice as well. So we were quite good friends. They were going to England.
So when was it decided, or when did you decide, actually, when did you decide to go to Spain?
To
Spain and then to Portugal.
Well, after 2 weeks, when I saw that my brother has no intention coming without his wife, I said, "Mommy, unless I go, we will be all trapped here. Please come with us. Come with me." So my father says, "No, I cannot, haven't got the heart to leave Jack behind and Danielle."
We take a tape break here.
Yeah.
This is tape 6. I'm interviewing Miriam Stanton.
Speak a bit louder.
You were just saying your parents wanted to stay to wait for your brother. You decided you wanted to go. So when did you go? And where did you go to?
I went to Portugal.
How did you?
Spain.
Right. Could you describe the journey from Nice to Spain?
Yeah. From Nice to Spain, my parents took me to the station, and so did my cousin Sim take me to the station. He gave me as a farewell present a bottle of perfume from, the bottle of perfume, I will come back to me, and I put it away. Instead of flowers, he gave me that bottle of perfume. And I went to the station, and I had to say goodbye to my parents. It was absolutely terrible. It tore my heart to pieces. I didn't know whether I will ever see them again, because that was a time that really and truly people, if they meet again, they were very lucky. And it was... In the compartment was Maria, a lady opposite me.
On the train?
In the train. And I made a mistake there. In the train, we came to the Spanish border. And when we came off the train at the station, there was one in uniform taking all the passports away to be stamped, and I was sick in my pit of my stomach to give away the passports. It was the most precious things I had, but everybody gave them, so they told us to wait in the restaurant, and after a quarter of an hour, half an hour, we ordered coffee, etc., and they came out with the passport. They called out and gave them the passport, and I was sitting there, and nobody called my name out. So I was sure that the Germans have reported me, that I disappeared. So I went in to the office. I say, "I am Miriam Sansa. You haven't called my passport out." He says, "Oh yes, I wanted to come to see you. Just wait a minute." And I took out from underneath the counter a big black book like that, and he started to count. to look, Sandra, 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 the name beats something in my mind, not in that book. So he put it away and brought another book. Sandra, 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 it's not in that book. Just wait a minute. He went to the office. You can imagine my heart. And I had a bunch of flowers and I buried my face in the flowers. I said, my God, don't tell me that I'm being caught now. Because what I was thinking, that in Vichy, when they requisitioned my suitcase, they knew that I'm somewhere leaving, because I went for the exit visa. So I was sitting there, and this was heartbreaking, and then he couldn't find it. And he says, just wait a minute. And he went into the office and came back. He says, where are you staying in Barcelona? I say, I don't know. Where do you suggest I should stay? He says, haven't you booked anything? I say, no, I haven't. So where did you intend to stay? So I say, I didn't intend to stay anywhere especially, but whichever is the nearest one. He says, how about a dinner tonight? Would you like to come at dinner, spend the evening with me? I say, only the evening? You can have the whole evening. Let me go now. Because if you don't let me go, the train will leave. And then we won't have an evening together. So he says, you're quite right. You phoned up right away to support it, to wait that he's bringing another person, passengers, and he put me into first class where I had second class. Put me into first class, and when I arrived in Barcelona, I went straight to the cash desk and bought myself a ticket to Madrid, and they had an extra ticket, extra train put on. The first train was an extra train to put on for the soldiers who ran away, to take them to Madrid, because the army was there. And also, it was 1st of April, and Franco's day, birthday of the day of Franco taking over Spain. So that I heard only from Maria, who was sitting opposite me. And she says, where have you booked? Because you won't have any space in any hotels, because in Barcelona. I say, I haven't booked anywhere. She says, stay with me. I say, with pleasure, but I would like to go to Portugal. She says, stay for the parade. It's beautiful, the parade. And she took me to the parade, and she pushed me forwards. And I was standing opposite Franco, and he was standing with his arm up, and all the soldiers passed by, and I thought to myself, here is Franco. What am I doing here? How can I get the hell out of here? So I went back, and I couldn't find Maria, and I didn't know where she had my suitcase, and I thought to myself, to hell with the suitcase, I'm going straight to the station. And all of a sudden I saw Maria, and I said, I'm going right now, I can't stay right here. So she says, I'll take you to the station. And she took me to the station. I don't remember how it was. She took me to the station. I went to Zorotogo. I went straight back to Portugal. Immediately, I couldn't stand Franco standing there. I couldn't wait that. To me, it was like Hitler standing there, you know. So I went back straight to the station, and I went to Marseille.
To Marseille?
No, to Portugal. To Portugal.
Where in Portugal?
Yeah. And when you came to the border and you came out of the station, it was like night and day. It was a clean, beautiful station, and all with the tiles, old tiles. It was really beautiful. And I went straight to Lisbon. with the next train. And when I came to Lisbon, snob as I am, I went to the best hotel, and Plaza Rocio, and who I met there, some friends of my father, Schulman's as well, and they begged me, they were leaving for Brazil, they can arrange a paper for me for Brazil, and I didn't want to go to Brazil because I wanted to go to England. And also I wanted to bring my parents out first. He says, don't worry, from Brazil you send them a visas. I say, I couldn't go to Brazil and leaving my parents behind, I'm sorry. So they, after a few days, they went to Brazil and I stayed there. And the Schulmans gave me some money, but I didn't want to accept the money because I couldn't repay them the money. But they decided they decided to go and not to force me, but they were very, very upset that I didn't go with them, and I stayed there in Portugal, and I left the hotel and rented myself a room on the 7th floor and no lift, but the right position. And I told the lady that I'm very, very hungry for breakfast. Give me 3 rolls, not 2 rolls. So I had 1 roll for breakfast, 1 for lunch, and 1 for supper.
Why did you do that?
Because I couldn't afford. I had only $50, you see. And also, I went every day to the Polish consulate to try to arrange something to go away and to bring my parents over. And in the Polish consulate one day, a lady with 2 children approached me, a blonde lady with a boy of 13 and a little boy of 6 or 7. And she says, I heard you being called Miriam Sanza. I say, yes. Are you related to Sanzas in Paris? I say, yes. She says, who are you? I say, I'm their daughter. She says, my husband is your mother's cousin. He was Schlesinger. And she said, that is Benno's, her husband's child from the first wife, and she had with him a little boy. And she wanted to leave him behind because she couldn't afford to take him with her. And I begged her not to do that. And we were allowed in Portugal to have 1 escudo a day from the Polish consulate and 1 escudo a day from the Jewish American joint. So I collected the 2 escudos a day. At the end of the week, I had 14 escudos and I gave it to her to keep the child. And he was a very lovely boy. And she says, why don't you adopt him? Take him. How can I come to my fiancé with an adopted child of 13? I mean, it's ridiculous. And then also, not only that, but how will I keep him? I haven't got to eat myself. And she has a visa to Canada. Why not go to Canada? She says she can't afford to take him to Canada. She has no money. So I say, if you promise me to go, I give you my $50. She took my $50 and she went to Canada.
With the child?
Yeah, she went to Canada and she took Benno with him. And we are in correspondence. He's coming next month over to visit me.
So what money did you have left now?
Nothing.
What did you do?
I took that ring, I pawned it. And I paid for 6 months' rent. I shouldn't have to sleep with somebody or sleep rough. I should have a roof over my head. And I told him, I'm very hungry. Please, please, please give me a lot of breakfast. And I kept it in my drawer, you know. And now the bottle of perfume was Guerlain, Mitsuko from Guerlain, which saved my life. My cousin Sim gave me that perfume with a bunch of roses. And the roses saved my life because I buried my face in the, when I was at the consulate.
At the border?
Pardon?
Wasn't it at the border you had the flowers?
At the border, yes, right. I buried my face. But I went to the Cuban consul and he said to me, I can give you a fictitious visa, but I can't give you a visa which is valuable because I'm not allowed to. But before that, I had a visa for Portugal for 2 weeks only. And every 2 weeks I had to go back to extend it.
Where?
Where? To the police station. And the chief of the police befriended me.
What was his name? Invited me in.
Now you're asking me. I forgot. Isn't that in my book?
I think it said Mr. Ruach.
Hmm?
Mr. Ruach?
Mr. Ruach, that's it. Mr. Ruach. And he introduced me to his family, and he looked after me, and he kept his passport in his pocket. And I didn't have to go to the police station anymore because he kept it every 2 weeks. He stamped it for me. One morning, 5 o'clock in the morning, I knock at the door. So I thought maybe a fire or something, and I opened the door. It was Mr. Ruach. He threw my passport on the bed, and he said to me, the police has been taken over by the army, and I haven't got the right, you don't know me, you haven't seen me, and he closed the door and ran off. So I dressed myself, and then I went down, we met all the people. I told them what happened. I said, you better go to the police station when you need it. Be careful, because Mr. Ruach has left now. He helped a lot of people, no question about it. And when I went, after 2 weeks, I went, and the policeman said to me, the chief wants to see you. I said, my God, what have I done now? So the chief invited me to come into his office, and we chatted away. And he sat on the settee, went over to the settee. He says, come sit next to me. I said, oh my God, don't tell me that. And he says, don't mind visiting you. Give me a little kiss. So I got up and I said, I am very sorry. If you don't want to stamp my passports, if I don't give you a kiss, I'm not selling my body. I'm sorry. I got up and I took the passport and I gave it to the man in front and I said, I want the stamps on it. He said, didn't you get the stamp inside? I said, no, I didn't. And I told Mr. Ruach that. What am I to do? He says, go to the chief. The chief is Peshutta Lacunia. And he will help you. But don't tell him that I told you. You go to Peshutta Lacunia. So I thought to myself, where is his office? And I remembered what I did in Spain. So I did the same thing in Portugal. His office was on the way to Estoril. I took the train, and from the train I took a taxi, and I went to his barracks, and the two soldiers crossed it. I couldn't go, so I just opened it. I said, "You have no right to stop me. I have an appointment with General Bishuta Dacunha, and I will tell him that you didn't let me go in. You better take me to his office." And they're shivering. And they took me to his office. One of them took me to his office. And I was sitting there, and my God, I thought to myself, my God, it was so cold. It was such a horrible place. It was very high, and on the top were the windows with gates on them, you know. I felt like I'm in prison. I said, what am I going to do now? So a medaled person came, and I said, mon generale, mon generale. He says, I'm not your general, I'm his aide-de-camp. Your general, mon general wants to see you. So I went in. It was a little man. And the office was very nice, with a carpet, with pictures, and bright light. And he said, sit down, sit down. He said, would you like a cup of coffee? I said, I would love to. So he gave me, as he ordered, a cup of coffee. He says, I don't remember having had an appointment with you. I never had an appointment with you, have you? I said, no, I have to apologize. He said, if you came for visas, get out. So I got up. He says, but I admire your courage. What do you want? So I told the admiral to go out. And I said to him, I didn't go to the police station, and I told him straight out what it was. He was furious. He was in such a state of fury that I have never seen anybody like it. I picked up the phone and phoned him to come immediately. Then he told me to go out to the other office. And the door was slightly open for me to hear. The admiral, he didn't know that, the general didn't know that, but the admiral opened slightly the door to hear it. A heel dress wiped the floor from him and tore off and degraded him. And chucked him out. First of all, he called me and he said, is that the man who asked you for a bazinga? I said, yes. He said, get out. And that's what he did to him.
Did you speak Portuguese by then?
At that time, I spoke Portuguese. I forgot it now because it's 50 years and I didn't use the language, but I do understand it. And because a year to be in the country, you learn the language, and I am very easy to learn the English as a language. And if I don't use it, I forget it very easily, you know, because I don't. I had never had an English lesson, you see. And so well, that's.
What happened? So now this man was thrown out.
What happened? He asked me, what is the problem? And I told him, I wanted visas for all my family. And he phoned the Portuguese consulate in Nice and told them to send a letter, to send a phone call or a letter, whatever it is, in order to Mr. and Mrs. Sansa at the Luxembourg Hotel to bring all the passports over and stamp them immediately and let them come. And they came. And can you imagine? He sent them a basket of flowers standing like that into the hotel room. And "You have a very brave daughter. Don't thank me. Thank your daughter." And we were all invited Sunday to lunch to the family.
Who is all of you?
My parents.
But your parents were still in...
To the family, to the general.
But your parents were still in Nice, weren't they?
No, they came. They came. He sent them visas. That's what I said.
This is after
he sent them visas for the whole lot. And they came. And when they came, they sent a big basket to the hotel and invited them for lunch.
We take a tape break here. Thank you.
That's the end of it.
This is the last part of today's interview, and we will continue the interview on another day.
March 1998. The survivor is Miriam Stanton. Last name at birth was Sansa. The interviewer is Emily Erbman. The city is London. The country, United Kingdom. The language used is English. And this is a continuation of the interview of March 16th. My name is Emily Erbman, E-M-I. L-I-E, E-R-B, M-A-N-N. Today's date is the 18th of March, 1998. I'm conducting an interview with Miriam Stanton in London, United Kingdom. The language used is English, and this is date one. What is your name, please?
Miriam Stanton.
Could you spell that, please?
S-T-A-N-T-O-N.
Could you spell Miriam, please?
M-I-R-I-A-M.
What is your maiden name?
Sandra. S-A-N-D-Z-E-R.
When were you born?
6th of May, 1914.
How old are you?
I think 83 and a three quarter.
Where were you born? Which city?
Warsaw.
Could you spell that, please?
W-A-R-S-O-W.
And which country is that?
Poland.
Thank you. We are now continuing the interview of last Monday, of the 16th of March. You were telling me about your arrival in Lisbon, your help of the help that the policeman, Mr. Roach, gave you. What was it like in Lisbon? Did you make any friends with other refugees?
Yes, quite a few. We were meeting in the Palladium restaurant, cafe restaurant, and we were meeting quite a lot of people in and out of Lisbon, quite a lot of refugees.
What sort of nationalities were they?
All kind of nationalities. Every country in Europe had representative from that country. We were Czechs and Austrian and Polish and Russian and Yugoslavian, and a lot of German Jews, and lot of Polish Jews as well. Polish people, especially, we had quite a lot of the army. The one who ran away, like the Polish army, a man in civilian clothes, and also the British who were trying to go back to Britain. And all the other countries who were represented there were meeting in those cafes, and everyone had a different cafe, you know. On the Avenida de Libertad, there was several cafes, and we all mixed, more or less.
Would you say that a majority of these refugees were Jews?
No, I wouldn't say so, because there were a lot of soldiers in civilian clothes who were in the Maginot Line, who were in the army, and when the German took over, they ran away. And they were getting civilian clothes. A lot of, surprising it is, a lot of farmers helped them out. They left their uniforms there, and the farmer gave them their clothes. The farmers were a great help in Free France, enormous help. They were maybe anti-Semitic in the core of their heart, but at that moment, a refugee was a refugee, and they were trying to help, especially in Portugal. They were very, very kind. They stopped you in the street and asked you, "Você é refugiado?" That means, "Are you a refugee?" And I said, "Yes." And they said, took out a card and gave me, or wrote down a piece of paper, their name and address and telephone number to phone them if I need any help. And that was a big change from France and from the other countries. They were very kind.
Yes, you were telling me, for instance, that in France the Jews were not allowed to rent an apartment or a room. They had to go into hotels.
Yeah.
Was that the case in Portugal?
No. In Portugal, everybody was equal.
Was there any anti-Semitism in Portugal?
No. None. Not that I knew of. I met quite a few Jewish families because I went to synagogue to see who is Jewish and who is not. And they befriended us, quite a few of us. And I must say that they have behaved beautifully. All the Portuguese people behaved beautifully. They were attached to Spain, and they were maybe even talking of camps and things like that, but they were only talking about it. They were not really acting upon it. They were helping the refugees. And one day I was in a restaurant, and I heard a lot of German talking. And I turned around, and I would have sworn that they were German soldiers in civilian clothes, like they did in France. They invaded France, actually, before the army came in. The soldiers had civilian clothes, and they were all over France. And once Hitler came over the border, they threw away the civilian clothes and put on their uniforms. And surprisingly enough, all of a sudden, there were in the streets plenty of German soldiers. And that was then we knew that we have to get out, and quickly.
Just to get back to Free France, were there many Germans crawling around Free France?
Well, I don't know. I don't know. I know that we were settled in Nice. We had in the Hotel Luxembourg 3 rooms, and also a room with a stove in it that we could cook our own things which we wanted. And that was on the Promenade des Anglais, just in front. And we saw quite a lot of, first of all, the Negresco Hotel is the best hotel in Nice, and that you could not get a room there because that was requisitioned by the German. And the German officers, when they had a holiday, a week's rest or something, they came down there in civilian clothes. And that was full of Germans, the Negresco. But all the others, well, we don't know, they mixed with people. We mixed with refugees, more or less. And the ones who spoke German, we didn't know whether they are refugees or soldiers, you know. And that's what they wanted, the French people.
Now, there were not that many Germans in Free France.
No.
Yet, Jews were being rounded up. Who by?
That was the Vichy government. That was they were rounded up only later on when it was fully occupied by the German people. Occupy the Free France as well. And most of the Germans were in civilian clothes.
Yeah, but you were telling me that when you were going to go to Vichy to get exit papers, you were told not to by the hotelier, who was a friend, because they would have kept you and sent you to Auschwitz. So that did happen before France was occupied.
That's right. That's right. Vichy was a very dangerous place because the government was there, you see. And the government actually went to Bordeaux because they wanted to go across to England, you see. And in Vichy, they were the sympathizers with Germany. And that was a very dangerous city for us Jews to go. Very dangerous. But the chief of the police was there. So, and I had for the exit visas to go to Vichy to get my exit visas. And I don't know if I told you that I was staying in the hotel.
Yes,
I did tell
me.
You.
Yes.
And that was a very, very nice French man who really liked us very much. And he was certainly not anti-Semitic because he helped a lot of Jewish people.
To go forward again to Lisbon, you were there on your own, waiting for your family to leave. I did read in your book the time about of Passover. Could you tell me about your Passover in Lisbon?
Yes. It was a very sad thing. We sat all the Jews together in the cafe, and somebody got a few packets of matzos, and we just put out the matzos. We couldn't have strictly kosher, because there were no kosher restaurants, and we couldn't have strictly kosher Passover. So we just took out the matzah and we said a few prayers on the matzah. And that was all we had. That was all we had. And we sat together and we chatted away. We didn't even have any prayer books. We had nothing, because that was early time before I met the Jewish community, you see. When I met the Jewish community, they were very, very sorry that they didn't meet me beforehand, and they would have invited me for Seder night, but it was too late, it didn't matter anymore. They were very kind to me, especially the Levy family. They were very, very kind and very nice family.
Do you remember their first names?
I might remember a little bit later when we talk about it.
Now, while you were in Portugal, did you manage to get a entry visa to the United Kingdom, to England?
Yes.
How did that go?
And there was... I had difficulties because I was going backwards and forwards to France, to occupied France. So I had difficulties in getting a visa. But eventually I got, because I went on a ship which was specially designed to go to England. And Mr. Ruesch, especially the Polish consulate, was very anti-Semitic. But they didn't show it, but they gave the seats or the cabins on the ship to the non-Jewish people. And when it was some empty seat, they sent a few Jewish people away. They had 500 visas a month from England and from Canada. And they could send either to England or to Canada the Polish people, because mainly for the soldiers. And when the soldiers were not enough soldiers, they sent Polish refugees. But all the Christian refugees had spaces, but not for the Jews.
And so eventually you got the visa from the Polish?
No. Mr. Ruesch intervened, and I got a visa from the Polish consulate to go on the ship. But I had another incident there. I walked in the street and I saw a friend of my father's, a Mr. Balsam. And I was so delighted that I'd hugged him, kissed him. I knew him all my life. And I said, have you seen my parents? He says, yes, I have seen yesterday your mother and your grandmother. They are all well. They are trying to come. But Jack isn't here, there. And I said to him, now, can we meet each other? He says, I have no time to see you. I have absolutely no time. But when I have time, I'll let you know. And then I spoke to my father, because I used to phone my father every second day, every day, whenever I could, reverse charges. And when I told my father that I met Mr. Balsam, because after I met him, I ran quickly to the telephone to tell my father. So he says, don't tell me you've met Mr. Balsam. I said, oh yes, I met Mr. Balsam. He says, he's a crook. I said, what are you talking about? It's your friend. He says, you know, he came up and borrowed $5,000 for an hour. At that time, was $5,000 very much money. And he disappeared. So ask him for the money. So when I saw Mr. Balsam again, I said, I just spoke to Papa. And he told me about the $5,000. He says, I told you I don't want to talk to you. It is not true. It is absolutely not true. So I said, look, my father wouldn't lie to me. I want some money from you. Well, we argued in the street so much, and I said, at least give me $100. I should be able to buy myself some food, because I had no food, cooked food, I mean. So he says, how can I lend you the $100? I don't know whether you will repay me. So I was terribly upset. You can imagine how upset. And I went up to my room and I cried my heart out. I didn't know whether I should tell Papa or not. Eventually, I told Mr. Ruesch. I didn't tell him the story, but I told Mr. Ruesch that I had a lot of unpleasantness with some refugees. So he says, look, is a ship going to England with Polish people? And I'm going to put you on that ship. Never mind, you had suffered enough, I'm going to put you on that ship. So he says, go to that and that travel agency and they will give you a ticket. And don't worry about the money, I will see to it. I will make the Polish consulate to pay for it. And I went to the travel agency. And they did give me a ticket. So I was absolutely delighted. And I had a little dog given by somebody. I had to give away my little dog to somebody. And I made farewell. We all farewell party. Everybody paid for themselves with a cup of coffee, with a cake or something. And I went to the ship the next day, sent my luggage and went to the ship. And as I was standing on the quay and talking to all my friends who I met there, chatting away, I saw somebody bringing down some luggage. The stewards were bringing down some luggage. So somebody said, look, they are bringing down some luggage. I wonder what it is. So I said, I don't know what it is. And all of a sudden, I had like a premonition that something is wrong. I said, look, let me go, say goodbye, and maybe it's something wrong there. Let me be on the ship. And I went on the ship. It's a bomb. That was my luggage coming down. And Mr. Ruesch was there with the captain. And the captain said, are you Mademoiselle Sanzer? I said, yes, I am. He says, you can't board that ship. I said, why not? I have a cabin here. He says, I'm sorry, you cannot board that ship. So I argued with him. So Mr. Ruesch said, excuse me, Captain, may I have a little word with Miss Sansa? So he took me away. He says, Miss Sansa, Miriam, please go off the ship. Otherwise, I have to take you by force, and I don't want to do that. Go voluntarily down off the ship, and I tell you all about it. And so I cried. I said, what is it? He said, I tell you all about it in my office. Come later on in the afternoon to my office, and I tell you all about it. And when I turned around, I saw Mr. Balsam laughing his head off, standing there laughing his head off. And I went down. You can imagine how upset I was. And Mr. Ruesch comforted me. And he says, go home, rest an hour, and then come and see me. And when I came to see him, he told me that, who is Mr. Balsam? I told him, he's a friend of my father. He said, he is not a friend of your family. He's an enemy of your family. I said, what do you mean with that? He said that you were traveling backwards and forwards to occupied France, and not only to occupy France, but Germany. And you sold dollars to the German soldiers and to the German officers. You were very friendly with them. And none of the people who are friendly with Germans can go to England because they have no time to investigate. They are busy with the war. after the war you will be able to go. So I told him the story about the $5,000. So he says, why didn't you tell me? He would have gone off, not you. But the ship was gone. But when I came to England, in Finchley Road, I saw Mr. Balzon.
When was this? Which year?
That was in 45, I got married, 46. I saw Mr. Balzon in England, in London. No, I'm making a mistake. I went to Paris and I saw him. I was sitting in a restaurant with my brother, my sister-in-law, and my husband, and myself and my younger brother. We were having a lunch together. And who walks in but Mr. Balzon? So my brother ran after him. But I also saw him in Finchley Road, sitting in the gutter and washing his feet because he was very tired from walking. Apparently he was interned in England when he arrived, because if he knew that I was trading with the Germans, they thought that he also was trading with the Germans, because the Germans wouldn't tell anybody. So he was interned right through the war, and after the war he was released. And then I saw him once in Paris, and then after that I never saw him again. He must have died in the meantime. But that was a friend of my father's who really and truly ruined my life. He ruined the war years, because I would have gone to England and I would have been able to bring my parents along, you see. And that's my story, why I didn't come to England during the war. After the war, I could come easily.
How did you... Oh, first of all, had you sent a message to your fiancé, Ben, that you were coming to England? Was he waiting for you?
No, well, unfortunately, the post was not very regular. And I did not get any... very few letters from him to Portugal, especially postcards. And the postcards were all written by hand, you know, and some were through the censors, they covered it up. Because he didn't know that he was talking things which were wrong. I live in so-and-so and I go so-and-so, you know, the addresses to give me. And that was stricken out. And I had a whole bunch of cards and letters, which 50% at least was stricken out.
We take a tape break here.
Pardon?
We take a tape break. This is take two. I'm interviewing Miriam Stanton. We were talking about
Lisbon.
Lisbon. You did not go to England. You were back in Lisbon. Now, how did you manage to... You say you phoned your parents every other day or your father. Now, was there any other way that you were in touch with your family?
Yes, they wrote to me. But when I went to the travel agency, I met a gentleman who was very kind to me, like all the Portuguese people were. And he introduced me to a captain, because I wanted to send some food parcels to my parents, because they had also very little food. So I sent them food like sardines and salmon in tins, you know, tin food. Small parcel, because I couldn't afford very big parcel. And he said to me, "Where are you going?" I said, "To the post office to try to send that parcel." He says, "Don't bother. I introduce you to a captain of the ship who travels regularly to Marseille. And he will get in touch with your parents, because he's staying a few days in Marseille to deliver some goods. And if we bring some goods from France." So I was absolutely delighted, and I sent them. I was introduced to the captain, and I gave him the parcel. And he, in turn, told my father, and I told him beforehand. And my father went to Marseille, and they got very friendly, the captain and my father. And he was traveling 2-3 times a month to Marseille, and every time he gave a parcel. One day he said to me, "Miss Sandra, don't bother to give me a parcel. I give him the stuff you're sending, I can give him from my ship stock, my food stock." So my father invited him to spend a week in Nice. And he came to Nice for a weekend and spent in our apartment and enjoyed it very much. And we became very, very friendly. And that was a time that I was trying to get my parents over. And I was in despair, because I could not get any permits at all. It was very difficult, because one day, morning, 5 o'clock in the morning, I had a knock at my door. I had a single room in an apartment on the 7th floor in the Avenida de Liberdade. And 5 o'clock in the morning, a knock at my door, must be a fire or something. So I rushed up, and it was Mr. Ruiz. And he threw my passport on my bed. He says, "You haven't seen me. It's in 2 weeks' time. You have to go on to extend the visas." The police was taken over by the army. Oh, I said, "My God, the fascists are here. What are we going to do?" And I was very upset. Of course, I couldn't sleep anymore. In the morning after breakfast, I went down and spoke to some refugees for coffee, and I told them that. And they also heard that the army has taken over the police in this. And it was a very sad day for us. Eventually, I had to go up to extend my visa.
May I just interrupt you? I'm sorry about it. Can I just ask you for the name of the captain and the gentleman who introduced you to the captain?
Oh, the gentleman who introduced me, I remember the name, but the captain was Carlos something or another, a Portuguese name which I cannot remember.
And
but the gentleman in the agency was Mr. Amzalak, but I don't remember his first name, you know? Mr. Amzalak. And he was very kind to me, with the permission of the owner, of the managing director of the travel agency. And what was I telling you?
You were now, I'm sorry to have interrupted you, you were talking to refugees, you'd heard that the army had taken over, and you had to get out in the next two weeks.
So I went after 2 weeks, because we had all of us had visas for 2 weeks in Portugal, transit visas. And after 2 weeks, they extended for another 2 weeks and another 2 weeks. So we had usually to go practically every 2 weeks over the year to the Portuguese consul, police station. And one day when the army took over, I was, when my day came, I had to go. My heart was in my mouth. What am I going to do? Will I finish off in a concentration camp? So it was a very nice, I think it was a colonel or lieutenant or something like that. And he was a very nice young man. And he says, leave me your passport, and we see to it. So I said, when shall I come back? He says, come back tomorrow. Usually, the ordinary police, you just stamped it for another 2 weeks. I come back tomorrow. So I came back the next day. And he says, come into my office. So I went into his office. I said, my God, no, not again. And he said to me, sit down on the settee. He had a glass settee there, don't in the armchair, sit on the settee. And I sat on the settee. He came next to me. And he says to me, don't mind beseeching you. This means, give me a kiss. So I looked at him. I said, I had no intention. I have no intention to sell my body for anything. So please, let me go. And I went out and was terribly upset, terribly upset. So I met Mr. Ruesch and I told him that. And he says, I said, isn't there anybody higher than that soldier there? So he says, yes, it is General Peixoto da Cunha. And don't ask me to spell it because I wouldn't remember how to spell it. Peixoto da Cunha. And I will never forget that name. And when he heard that, and Ruesch told me that his office is not in Lisbon. It's halfway to Estoril. If you know the coast, it's from Lisbon to Estoril. Halfway to Estoril. And you have to go there if you want to see him. Whether he will help you, I don't know. But tell me the results. But don't tell anybody that I told you that. So I took the train. I dressed myself. I remembered what I did in the Spanish consulate. I remember that the Portuguese people are the same as Spanish people. They like beautifully dressed women. So I dressed myself up the best I could. And I took the train because I couldn't afford a taxi. But from the train to the barracks, I took a taxi for a few coppers. And they stopped me outside the barracks. And when I came, two soldiers were standing, and they crossed the guns and said, you can't go in. Where are you going? I say, I have an appointment with General Peixoto da Cunha. Oh, they said. Instead of phoning him, they said, oh, they had such a respect for me because he was the king of Lisbon, you know. So one soldier said to the other, take her to the office. And he took me to the office, and I was sitting there in one terrible state. What am I going to do? So after about 15 minutes waiting, from one of the doors, to me it was a general, he was full of medals. I say, mon generale, in French I told him what I wanted. So he says, I'm not General Peschuta da Cunha, I'm his adjutant, but I will tell him that you are here. And so he went in, and after a few minutes he came out, General Peschuta da Cunha will receive you. Well, I went in. The general was a lovely man, and he was sitting with his hands folded like that, and got up to greet me and let me to sit down, and like a gentleman, and asked me whether I would like a cup of coffee. I said, I would love to. And he said to me, what did you come for? I don't remember having made an appointment with you. In fact, I don't know you at all. So I burst out crying. I just couldn't restrain myself any. So I was sobbing away. And he was very patient to wait for me. And when he says, now drink your coffee, and then you tell me the story. If you came for a permit, to stay permanently here. No way. They will ask you to leave. So I say, I didn't come for that. I came for something else. He says, now I'm all ears. And I told him the story of the police station. How I don't want to sell my body. Whilst I love my family, but I know that my father would have been very, very annoyed with me and very cross with me, and quite rightly so. And I don't want to do that. Is there any other way I can bring over my family? He says, when was that? So I told him. He says, so he rang the bell, and the first officer came through the other door and says, yes, will you take Miss Sansa in to your office? And he picked up the telephone, but that other officer left the door a little bit open. I should hear what is happening, because by that time I spoke Portuguese. And he was screaming his head off. Absolutely screaming his head off, and threw the telephone out. And then he came in and he said, I hope you have time, but you have to wait a half an hour. I said, yes, I do have time. I have time all day long, if it's necessary, to save my family. And after half an hour, my officer came in and he called me in. He said, is that the gentleman who asked you for the Bisigno? I said, yes, that's the fellow. And he said, would you go out? I said, yes. He gave him hell, absolute hell, and he tore off his lapel, this I don't know what you call that, you know. And told him to get out. Called first two soldiers, and he was arrested. And took him out. And then called me in. And he says, will you give me the name and address of your parents? And he called the Spanish, the Portuguese consulate in France, in Marseille, to send for my parents, that address. And he says, red carpet for them, it's a lot of them. And 2 weeks later, they came. And he, Peshuta Dacunha, sent me a big basket of flowers to my parents to tell them what a brave daughter they have got. And from that on, I had a very, very easy time.
So what happened to your brother Jack meanwhile?
Pardon?
What had happened to your brother Jack
meanwhile? Well, my brother Jack in the meantime came a few days later after I left. He came to Paris.
To Paris?
Yes, he came to Paris. Oh, he had Argentinian papers because I've arranged for him Argentinian papers, identity card, so he was Argentinian. And he came to Paris to his wife and child. And we were sending telephone calls and bombing to come for them. And they didn't come. She would not leave my sister-in-law. She wanted either all her family to come, her mother and her father and her two sisters, or she's not coming and the baby's not coming. So telephones were going backwards and forwards and backwards and forwards. And eventually I said to my parents, and I had visas, I was traveling every week, Monday to Marseille till Friday. And from consulate to consulate, we all wanted to go to Cuba because it's near the United States, because the United States visa was like £1 million dowry or £10 million dowry, a United States visa. Only a very few got it. And when I went to the United States consulate, they told me, yes, you can have a visa, but you have to wait. It's a waiting list for Polish people. For 10 years. So I did not bother with United States, but I tried any other consulate. Eventually I heard that Shanghai is giving visas, Chinese people.
I think you told me that story, because they gave you the visa, but the ship had sailed.
Yes, but also, I had also to have, Mr. Amzalak gave me also a Cuban piece on a ship, a Cuban paper, and he spoke to the Cuban consul. And also Mr. Ruash spoke to the Cuban consul to give me fictitious visas for my family, which we had to, when they came, we had to go up to the consul, and he cancelled them.
And then what happened?
Well, we had to do something about it. We had to leave, and we just did not know where to go. It was very, very, very difficult. And it was desperation, absolutely desperation. The police was urging us to leave because they wanted some work. As they sent out 500 people, 500 soldiers can come in, you know, other people can come in. And it was pathetic what we went through. We were sitting in the cafe and discussing, helping each other to do something. Eventually, we got a Cuban visa, a fictitious Cuban visa, on which my parents could come. But now where to go? As a Polish consulate, all those ships, which had 500 visas, free visas to Canada and to England, sent the non-Jewish people, but not the Jewish people. And there was an accumulation of a couple of thousand of Jewish people. And the police had to clear us out, somehow or another. It was very difficult. So, what happened there? The to be frank, it's very difficult for me to talk about it because it is choking. Like, we had the visas annulled, but we had to do something about it. So the Polish consulate, the Polish Jews decided, one fellow was a Dr. Schlichter. He was a medical doctor from Belgium. And he suggested that we should send a telegram to Churchill. He must have sometimes a birthday. He's born sometimes. Let's wish him happy birthday to you. And all the very best. Great success for the war. But please, we are Polish Jews. Send us somewhere in the world under the British flag. And 2 weeks later, we were called to the Polish consulate to bring the passports. But I had, a letter was sent. I didn't get with the first post the letter from from Polish consulate. And I knew that the 2 weeks are over and I will probably finish off in a concentration camp with my family. So I went to the hairdresser to have my hair done. At least let me look decent when I go somewhere. I had my hair done, and somebody came running and asked me whether I have had a Polish call from a letter from Polish consulate. I said, no, I didn't have one. So I went quickly home, and I found a letter there. And we all amalgamated. What happened there was that we decided we are going to, just a minute, I'm muddling it up, I think. We decided, we decided that we are going to go to go to the Polish to the to send a telegram to Churchill to help us.
Yes, you just.
Yes, I said that, and we had the help, and I went to the Polish consulate, and I also got a permit to go on the ship.
To where?
They told us, didn't tell us, but under the British flag. And when we arrived on the ship, they told us we are going to Jamaica. And it was very peculiar that I met some relations of mine as well on the ship, on the quay, and she was going to Canada with another ship. She was going to Canada because the Polish consulate got a telegraph that that they have really missed out, and they had a bad name for Jewish people not to allow them, you know. And they found that the Nazis have influenced them, you know. But they must have influenced them that we should not have the visas. But we went to Jamaica, and it was a great relief to me that we are going under the British flag.
Who were you with on the ship to Jamaica?
Now, the ship, as it happened, the ship was a cargo ship which was built specially for the refugees. Three boxes, like three to sleeping beds, you know. But when I came on the ship, the captain was my captain, my friend. I didn't realize it. And he said, Miss Santa, you and your family are not sleeping in those. You have three cabins. So my grandmother had a cabin, my parents had a cabin, and I had a cabin. And we had three cabins, and we were sitting at the captain's table for the meals. It was a very nice trip to Jamaica.
When were you told you were going to Jamaica?
It was, I think, January, around January.
No, but how long had you been on the ship before you were told that you were going to Jamaica?
On the ship, as we arrived.
And when, what year are we talking about that you were on your way to Jamaica?
January, I think it was January 41, something like that.
Now, you say you were on the ship with your parents and your grandmother.
Yeah.
What about your two brothers?
My two brothers were military age, and they had to remain in Portugal.
To fight for which party?
So we had to part, and it was a heartbreaking thing. Then we were united. All of a sudden, we had to part.
But who did they have to fight for in Portugal?
Yes, but they were military.
But did they have to fight on the side of the Portuguese or the Free French? Or
the Free French, I suppose. I don't know. I suppose the Free French.
So the ship, was it a nice journey to Jamaica?
It was a very nice journey and was very, very comfortable for me. But the others were very jealous. And we went, the first stop was Casablanca. And Casablanca, we took on some more Belgium refugees. And about 50 or 60 Belgium refugees. And they were kept themselves separately from us Polish people. There were also Jewish people there. And when we came to Casablanca, we saw the ship going backwards and forwards and backwards, the little boat with the captain going backwards and forwards. We didn't stop inside the harbor. We stopped in the outside. And when I asked him what it was, I said, I can only tell you, but please don't even tell your parents. We have a typhus, we have, in Jamaica that was, a typhus case in Jamaica. On the ship, we picked him up in Casablanca. He's a Belgian Jewish young fellow. And we are in quarantine. Now, if you go down, I want you to help me. If we go, all of you refugees go down, you will be in quarantine. But it's, and you will be in a camp. And I went to see the camp. The camp is a very nice place, not too bad. It's not a concentration camp. It's a camp.
It was an internment camp?
No, in Jamaica. It wasn't a German camp.
No, an internment camp.
Internment camp, yes, but not a concentration camp. We were free to go in and out as much as we can. But in Casablanca, was a typhus case, so we had to be 6 weeks in quarantine.
We take a tape break here.